set free. By grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, through His blood. And guess what? I'm all that God said I am. What did He say? He said I was justified. He said, I was sanctified. He said, I shall be glorified. Don't be fooled by what you see. Don't be fooled by the unfinished work. I'm looking at the author and finisher. He said, I started and I finish it. That's why I can say it beforehand. You're all that I said you are. Because He has the ability to finish what He started. So He can say without finishing it, I'm all that He says I am. But also because He sees the end. Right now, He sees me finished. He sees me perfected in holiness. He sits outside of time.
The boat with the hired servants and followed him.
Amen.
You see, Mark using his favorite word.
Yes.
Remember when I talked to you about genre?
Yes.
Immediately. Immediately. Mark draws you in. You're there. That's the word of God, isn't it? Father, we thank you so much. What a gift we have in your word. Oh, what a gift. What a precious, precious gift. It's one of those gifts that we just cannot do without. We would have never seen Christ if it wasn't for your word. We could not grow in sanctification if it wasn't for your word. We would know nothing about our future glorification if it was not for your word. We wouldn't have hope in tribulation if it wasn't for your word. We wouldn't know joy of our salvation if it wasn't for your word. So we thank you. Your word is precious, holy, infallible, inerrant, sovereign, authoritative, and it's clear. And here I stand, a mere man, to proclaim your word. Father, if it was not for your calling, I dare not try to handle such a book as this. But I can't help it. You call me. There's a woe in me if I not preach. So I seek to preach, but still I tremble because I don't want to say anything wrong. So again, Lord, I am so thankful for the privilege of prayer, because I know I can ask you to use me, and I know it's your will to use me. I know I can ask you by your spirit to fill me, and I know it's your will that I be filled by your spirit and control my, that he control my mind, my emotions, and my will, everything that I say. And I ask that you would grant me that grace right now. Grant me that feeling. Grant me that enablement, that empowerment. Grant me that grace to preach in the power and demonstration of the Holy Spirit, so that you use me to handle, to proclaim your word. And oh, Heavenly Father, I pray for the Spirit's grace of illumination to cause us all to see clearly your will for our lives, to see clearly your guidance and your direction for our lives, to see clearly your Son who reigns and rules over our lives, to see clearly what it means to bow and submit to the Lordship of Christ, to see clearly what it means to be a disciple of Christ, to see clearly the authority of Christ over our lives for our good and for his glory. Cause us to see that clearly and enable us to bear fruit in every good work. Put work in our desires, work in our thoughts and our intentions and our motives. Make us eager from the inside out to be and live as disciples of Christ, submitting to the word of Christ, following the lordship of Christ, all for the glory of Christ. Make us eager, Lord, to see other men and women, boys and girls, brought to salvation through the preaching of the gospel of Christ. Get glory, Heavenly Father. Get glory. In Jesus' name. Amen. This message continuing the same theme that runs, that started at verse 14 and really runs to chapter 8. The theme of the authority of Christ. The authority of Christ. We began looking at that authority on last Lord's Day. And what we saw last Lord's Day was was this Jesus' authority and how he had an authoritative message, right? An authoritative message came from the Messiah, the King. John was a transitional figure as John is in prison. Okay, that's helping us to see the transition from Old Testament to New Testament, the transition from John to Jesus. And John does not come out of prison. He ends up being beheaded and passing the baton, so to speak, to Jesus Christ, our Lord. And Jesus comes on the scene and into Galilee, and he's proclaiming the gospel of God. Why is it the gospel of God? Because the gospel has its origins in God. It's not something that man came up with. Okay, it has its origins in God. Why is it the gospel of Jesus Christ? Because apart from the person and work of Christ, there is no such thing as the gospel. Why is it the gospel of grace? Well, it's the gospel of grace simply because this is only by grace that you can receive this gospel. Why is it the gospel of the kingdom? Because when you submit to the lordship of Christ by faith, you come into, you're brought into the kingdom of God. That's when he came preaching. Came preaching the gospel. And we saw the gospel, the necessity of the gospel. Since it is the gospel, automatically we see the necessity. If he came preaching it, it's because we needed it.
Yes, sir.
If he came preaching, it's because we were depraved. If he came with good news, it's because we are filled with bad news. If he came preaching the gospel, it's because we were under judgment. He came preaching the gospel. The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Why is the kingdom of God at hand? Is at hand presently because the king is here. That's Jesus. And we saw that the kingdom of God speaks of the rule and the reign of God. Christ, the Messiah, is here. And he sets up his reign, his rule, in hearts. We saw the right now, not yet tension with the kingdom. The kingdom is here right now, but it's not yet in all of its consummation. Oh, but when the king returns, everything will be made right, and we will forever live and worship the king. We saw the demands of the kingdom, okay? We saw the demands of the gospel message. What's the demand? Repent and believe. And I showed you that you can't have one without the other. Remember, we looked at some grammar, okay? These are present tense imperatives. The command to repent, the command to believe, present tense imperatives, which means repenting is believing, believing is repenting, although, they are not the same in terms of definition. They are the same in terms of action. You can't believe unless you repent. And you can't repent unless you believe. So much for a belief, or easy believism, that doesn't result in a changed life. If a person's life is not changed, they have not repented.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
He continues walking in his authority. He continues walking in his authority. And Mark here really shows us that the disciples that Jesus chose were qualified to be witnesses of his entire ministry. Not qualified in the sense that they were pre-qualified before he chose them, but because he chose them, then they were qualified to be witnesses of his entire ministry. These guys really do know what they're talking about. when they speak about Christ, because Christ chose them at the very beginning of his ministry. We see here the importance of discipleship. I'm going to talk about it in a minute. We see here the way in which all people need to respond to Jesus' summons, promptly and completely. We see the inseparable relationship here of discipleship and Christology. You cannot have a true disciple unless he submits to the true Christ. We see here who takes the initiative in making disciples. Jesus. They're not seeking him. He came to them. So let's hear then the authority of Christ, the authoritative Christ who came preaching an authoritative message. Now he comes with an authoritative call. So let's look at the authoritative call of the king. Boy, this is good. The authoritative call of the king, as we pick this up at verse 16. Note the setting for the call. Passing alongside the Sea of Galilee. Passing alongside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Notice the place of this call. It's the Sea of Galilee. It's no doubt in my mind that the Lord Jesus had walked beside this lake 100 times in the years of his growing up. Why do I say that? Well, Nazareth, you know, he grew up in Nazareth. Nazareth was only 20 miles from Capernaum on the lake where his relatives live. The Palestine of Jesus' day was only about 140 miles long and 23 miles wide in the north and 80 miles wide in the south. Now, in relation to where Jesus grew up in Nazareth, that would mean that Jesus knew every crook and cranny of this lake. He had walked this way many times before as a child. He had walked this shoreline many times before. But this time he walks with a special purpose in mind. The Sea of Galilee is 60 miles from Jerusalem. It is from 80 to 160 feet deep. It lies 680 feet below the level of the Mediterranean. 9 cities, including Tiberias, bordered it, each having a population of some 15,000 or more people. This sea in the Old Testament was called the Sea of Shinnereth, coming from a Hebrew root word, kinnor, that means harp. Why did they call it that? Because it was shaped like that. It was shaped like a harp. Josephus, a Jewish historian, he extols the Sea of Galilee for its pure, sweet, and many species of fish, its fertile soil and pleasing climate that supplies fruit and produce 10 months of the year. He went on to say the whole region is one in which nature has taken pride. It's an important place. It is a rich and beautiful place where Jesus is walking here. It has much significance. It's a little lake in terms of size, but it's a veritable sea in terms of significance, because half of the Lord's recorded miracles were performed in the immediate vicinity of the Sea of Galilee. It's a mere dot on the geography of our planet, but it is a vast ocean in the thinking and the hymnology of the church. It is important because of what happens here. This place dominates the Gospels. It was near the Sea of Galilee, for example, where Jesus gave the Sermon on the Mount, many of his parables as well. It's here that his name first leaped to fame. It's here that he found his closest followers and friends, as Mark here reminds us. That's the setting as to where Jesus is. We have the Lord of glory, the King of glory. We have the Messiah, the unique Son of God, the one who's one in essence and being with God. Jesus Christ, who is fully God, fully man. We have him, the King. He does not come to the palace to call disciples. He's walking along the shore of the lake. That's the setting. Notice the people who are called. He mentions four, doesn't he? We have this guy named Simon. You know that's Peter, right? You know that's Mr. Impulsive. Peter the Impulsive. Peter became the leader of the 12. He's mentioned first in every list of the apostles. We have his brother, Andrew. You know Andrew, right? That's the guy that's always wanting to bring people to Jesus. That's Andrew. You find him in John chapter 1, 40 and 42. He likes bringing people to Jesus. Then you have Zebedee's sons, James. You know James, right? James was the first martyr. He was the first one to die as a martyr. First apostle to die as a martyr of the 12. He was the first one. You find him in Acts chapter 12. Right? Yep. Acts chapter 12. You remember John was arrested and James was beheaded. Yep. They couldn't cut Peter's head off because Jesus had already prophesied how he would die, and that wasn't the way he would die, so it was impossible for them to do that. Amen. But James was the first martyr of the 12. He got his brother John. Y'all know John, that's the disciple whom Jesus loved. Jesus had a very close and intimate relationship. With John, very tender relationship. In fact, Peter, James, and John are going to be the closest of Jesus' disciples, a group that is referred to as the inner circle. All four of these men had something in common. They were fishermen. Notice what the first two were doing. They were casting their net. They were casting their net. Now the fisherman gathered the net on his arms and he heaved it forcefully outward in a secular motion so that it would land sort of like a parachute on the lake, trapping fish as it sank to the bottom because of the weights that were put at the end of it. So it had weights at the end of it. It would throw it out on the lake and it would sink to the bottom and gather up all up under it. They got the fish, because once it sank to the bottom, this is how they got the fish. They would dive to the bottom, and they would gather the weights together and drag the net to the shore. That's what Simon and Andrew were doing when Jesus called them. They were casting their net. Well, what was James and John doing? James and John, they were in the boat, in the water, but they were mending their nets, getting ready for the next fishing expedition. When they mend their nets, they're not just repairing broken places, but they're also cleaning and folding the nets after the night's work. And they're not in some little rowboat, but they're in a fishing vessel equipped for sailors. Why am I giving you this background information? Well, you got to keep listening. Fishing was a thriving industry on the Sea of Galilee in the first century. Fish, not meat, was the staple food of the Greco-Roman world. Fish from the Sea of Galilee were exported and prized in distant Alexandria in Egypt and Antioch in Syria. They didn't just sell around town. These fishermen were very skilled and they competed in the larger Mediterranean market. And the fact that they did that testifies to their skill, to their financial prosperity, to their ingenuity. But also, here's something important. It also testifies to their command of the Greek language, which would be important in the writing of Scripture. Yeah. I have some warriors here.
Yeah.
Greek was the international language of business and culture. It's great to call some men who have a command of the Greek language. That's going to be useful later. So, I want you to get this. I think we have a few fishermen in this congregation, don't we? I want you to get this. There were not two boats out there. This was a business. There could have been 1,000 or more vessels out there. This was a business that supplied fish even beyond their territory. It was a very competitive business. It was a business that required a great deal of skill and ingenuity. These are not men sitting by the water with a pole in the water, hoping to catch something. And a little thing of bait right here, this bait in their hook. They didn't have rods, they had nets. These are men who were, these are not indigent labor, day laborers. These are men who are entrepreneurs, they had a business. All right? So don't think they caught one or two fish a day. No, their business required much more than that. They needed to be very shrewd businessmen in order to be successful businessmen. So don't think these men were poor men that didn't have anything. And sometimes we might view this as Jesus is walking along the lake that, well, they really didn't have much to give up. No. They gave up their business. I have some warriors here. When they drop their nets, they threw away their business license. I need you to go with me. You see the setting for the call, right? That's the setting. Beautiful Sea of Galilee, as he walks along the shores there, really by the lake there, he gives them a call. There's more than two boats out there. So he calls them out of a crowd of people. Right? He picked them out. He chose them. I mean, he comes acting as if he knew who was his.
Yeah.
I can't stay there, right? And he chose them. There were plenty of fishermen out there. There were plenty of men out there. There were plenty who were casting their nets, perhaps plenty who were mending their nets. And he said, Simon. Now, think about this. It would not have been a quiet place. It would have been a noisy place. These are working men. The water's moving. Nets are moving. Men are talking. There's, watch this, a thousand or more ships out there. So Jesus would have had to say, Simon, Andrew, James, John. Come follow me. Are you with me? You see the setting for the call. I want you to see, secondly, the call to follow. The call to follow. I want you to see three things about the call to follow that rest in verse 17. Three crucial points concerning the call to follow. Notice first in verse 17a and also in verse 20a, we see the nature of the call. In other words, what kind of call is this? Right? What kind of call is this? Verse 17 says in verse 17, first part of verse 17 reads, and Jesus said to them, follow me. Stop right there. In verse 20, and immediately he called them. So we got Jesus in verse 17 saying, follow me. Verse 20, he called them. We need to understand what is meant by follow, what is meant by call, and then we need to bring it together and give you some principles concerning what Jesus is saying and what does it mean to follow him. What does it mean by follow? That's a translation of a Greek word. Actually, watch this, catch this. This is extremely important. That's the translation of a Greek word. In fact, the same Greek word that Jesus used is just translated differently in English. When he went to the grave of Lazarus and called Lazarus to come forth, that's the same word here that's translated follow. When he said to Lazarus, come forth, that's the same Greek word that is used here. Wait a minute, wasn't Lazarus dead?
Yes.
Wasn't he stinking by now? I need you to stay with me here. Let's see some things about this word. It's an imperative, so it's a command. It's an imperative verb, which means not only is it a command, but it's a command that demands action. It is non-negotiable. Non-negotiable. It's an all-encompassing mandate from the King. That's Jesus. So, what is the idea? Did you turn me down? Turn me back up. What is the idea behind this word? The idea behind this word is responding to a summons, attachment to a person, submission to authority, imitation of example, implication of continuation and pursuing a goal is also included in this word. So what's the idea included in this word? When Jesus said follow, the idea is you got to respond to that summons. You got to attach yourself to this person. You've got to submit to his authority, and you got to seek to imitate his example, and you got to continue doing that until the goal for which he called you to follow is reached. Do I have warriors in this place? The word called in verse 20, it means summons. Isn't that interesting? How Jesus uses two different Greek words. It means to authoritatively communicate a demand for the presence and participation of someone. You remember that this section is about authority, the authority of Christ, right?
Yeah.
Remember, this section is about the authority of Christ. And here's what the word call means, if you want a definition. It means to authoritatively communicate a demand for the presence and participation of someone. Wow. Who can do that? Can you do that? I can't do that. So whoever can do that has to be somebody who, when he does that, he's going to cause to happen in that person what he wants. Sounds like an effectual call. Right? Is that what it sounds like to you? It sounds like that when Jesus said, follow me, when Jesus called them, it sounds like to me that Jesus sought to effect in them what he was demanding of them. Right? It sounds like that his purpose would be effected by the call, right? I want you to notice how that's true here. Jesus called these men, and watch this, they dropped everything, came, and followed him. So that means his call was different from my call to you. My call to you, come to Jesus. My call to you, put your trust in Jesus. But Jesus' call was not merely outwardly. Jesus' call was inwardly. Yeah. Diane from Warriors here. Jesus, is, by his very call, affected the very disposition of their hearts. Jesus' call effected the transformation of their souls. Jesus' call moved them from spiritual death to spiritual life. You're wondering why they dropped everything? Is it a surprise to you that they dropped everything? Watch this. It should be a surprise. You should be surprised. If the call came from Matthew, you should be surprised. You should be surprised if the call came from Abraham. You should be surprised. You should be surprised if the call came from Ezekiel or Elijah. You should be surprised. But nobody should be surprised because of who the call came from. Why are you surprised that they would drop everything for him? Perhaps you're surprised because you haven't done it. I'm going to move right. So, let me pull this together for you. I'm still in verse 17. Pray for me. What is Jesus saying when he says, follow me? What is he saying when he calls them? What does it mean to follow Christ? What does it mean to be a disciple? What kind of call is this? What does it entail? Number one, I'm pulling together the definitions I just gave you. Number one, Jesus is calling each person, each of these disciples, each of these men, to follow him preeminently. What's the name, Pastor? In other words, following Christ, heeding this call, must take priority over everyone and everything in your life.
Amen.
The number one priority in life is to follow Christ.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
This call jumped to the head of the list.
Amen.
Then it jumped to the head of the list.
Amen.
Nothing can overshadow this call. Right now, this call is the most important decision in anybody's life.
Amen.
If you don't answer this call, it will determine your destiny.
Amen.
Have I got any warriors here?
Yeah.
Are you following Jesus? Have you answered the divine summons? Are you walking with him? It's a preeminent call. I want you to see, secondly, it's a call to follow him repentantly. We saw that in verse 15, he said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, right? The kingdom of heaven is at hand because the king is here, right? Repent and believe the gospel, right? So in order to follow Jesus, there had to be repentance. There had to be a godly sorrow of sin. There had to be a turning away from my old life to follow him. And that is beautifully illustrated for us, isn't it? Because repentance is absolutely necessary to follow Jesus. He's holy, he's sinless, Son of God. He's never walked in sin or even pursued unholy pleasures. Those whom he calls must turn their backs on their sin and renounce the evil world system. Then and only then will you set your face in the pursuit of personal holiness. You can't follow Jesus without abandoning your own life. So he's saying, follow me repentantly. What is another thing he's saying? He's saying, if you follow me, you better follow me believingly. In other words, Jesus is saying, you got to come to me by faith.
Yes.
Jesus, you didn't tell these guys where you're going to take them. He said, sure did. You didn't tell them all that was required to be your disciple. He said, sure didn't. You didn't explain who else will be joining him. Sure didn't. The singular requirement, follow him, trust him, believe in him, put your faith in him. Whether the whole crowd will come or no one else will come, the singular responsibility of you and I this morning, regardless of who else decides to believe and trust in Christ, you better follow him believingly. You know what that means, don't you? They're leaving their business. So that means they have trust him for everything. I got territory to cover, so I have to stay still this morning. What does it mean to follow Christ? He has the preeminence. You got to follow him repentantly. You got to follow him believingly. But he calls them to follow him wholeheartedly. You can't have one foot in the boat. Right? You can't hold back any part of your life. You can't be half in and half out. They couldn't come to him while remaining in the boat, could they? To follow him wholeheartedly means that the whole life has to be surrendered to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. He doesn't want half of your life. When you follow him, you don't have a secular life, you have a spiritual life. No, sir. It's not leave Jesus on my job and I'll deal with him on Sunday. Right? You gotta follow him wholeheartedly. Jesus says, now your whole life, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, must be all done to my glory, must be all done believing in me, must be all done trusting in me. Otherwise, you're not following. Right? Jesus doesn't want half of your heart. He sends his spirit to indwell the entire being. You gotta follow him wholeheartedly. Right? You with me? What does it mean to follow Jesus? What is he saying? Jesus is saying, you got to follow me primarily. I got to be first. I got to be the priority. You can't have Jesus in your stuff. You can't have Jesus in what you want. You can't attach Jesus to your sinful lifestyle. You got to follow Jesus repentantly. You got to turn, right? You got to follow Jesus believingly, trusting in him. You got to follow him wholeheartedly. One more thing. You got to follow Jesus unconditionally. Jesus says, watch this, I'll give you this in a minute, but nobody said, but yes, you need to give up my business. Jesus says, follow me no matter what it requires, because I'm worth it. Right? Unconditional. He finds them where they are, and he says, but you've got to come right now. I didn't have to call you in the first place, and I don't have to call you again. You got to come right now. I don't have to give you an opportunity to hear the gospel no more. So when I call you, come right now, unconditionally. No matter what you've got to give up, step out and come right now.
Amen.
That's a radical call. It's no less radical today.
Amen.
We see it in the nature of the call. You see what kind of call this is, don't you?
Yes, sir.
I want you to see, secondly, the uniqueness of the call. He said, come, follow me. Why do you say this is unique, Pastor? Well, it's a call to discipleship, a relationship of loyalty to a master teacher. Jesus is the Lord Christ, no doubt about it. But he's also a teacher. He's also a rabbi, isn't he? And he says, you got to get this contextually, okay? You got to get this according to the historical context of Jesus' day as to why it was so unique. Jesus said, the rabbi, the teacher, the master, he said to them, come, follow me. That was uncommon, unheard of for any Jewish rabbi. That was not their pattern to seek out students. Usually with a rabbi, the students would seek them out and attach themselves to learn the law and pass on that tradition to their fathers. You never had a rabbi seeking out a student. Right? You never had a rabbi seeking out a student and saying to that student, I'm not calling you to follow the law. I'm calling you to follow me. I'm not saying attach yourself to the law. I'm saying you must attach yourself to me. Rabbis can do that. Even when they had students, there was an attachment to the law. They set up under a rabbi in order to learn the law so they could pass on those traditions down. And the rabbi never came looking for them. They always came looking for him to be his student. What kind of rabbi is this? Right? He doesn't say, follow the law. Right? He says, follow me. He doesn't wait on them to come looking for him because he knows they'll never come looking for him. But the rabbi is walking by the seashore and he comes looking for them. Y'all don't hear me. I wish I had somebody in here with me. Now if you read John chapter 1, particularly verse 35 to 42, you know that Peter and Andrew, they had met Jesus before. This is not their first meeting. Okay? They had some prior acquaintance with Jesus before their call. Well, Mark omit that. You know why Mark omits that? Because of his purpose in writing. Mark says, I let John write that. My purpose right here is I want you to see the authority of Christ. Right? I want you to see that he came searching. I want you to see that it is in their world that discipleship begins. I want you to see that when God's Son initiates human fellowship, the encounter doesn't take place on holy ground. It takes place. It doesn't even take place in the temple or the synagogue. But it takes place in the world of boats and ships out on the lake. Y'all have any warriors here? I'm glad. I've got to
pause for just,
can I pause for a second? I am glad that this Jewish rabbi, the Holy Son of God, the chosen Messiah of God, I'm glad that he called me and he came to where I was. Y'all don't hear me, do you? I would have never come looking for him. I was like him. I had heard about him many times. I grew up in church. Jesus' name was not foreign language to me. But I'm glad that he came to where I was. Isn't that good news? I'm glad that I responded to the call. This is a unique call because we have a unique Savior. There's nobody like him. Comes looking for unworthy, wretched sinners like us. What in the world is Jesus doing walking in the muddy waters? You know he had to get out there a little bit for them to be able to hear him. What a unique Savior. And he says, follow me. Listen, y'all know how I hold the Bible in high esteem. But the Bible doesn't save us. Jesus does. It is through the instrument or the means of his word, but he saves us. Right? I got some warriors in this place. Jesus said, follow me. I don't want to be misunderstood here. To follow his word and trust him in him by faith, you follow him. But you can have his word and not follow him.
Right?
That's right. I better move on. You see the uniqueness of the call, right? You see the nature of the call? I want you to notice thoroughly the intention of the call. It's in verse 17, and I will make you become fishers of men. Wow. That word make, don't miss that. These words are so important. It means to cause, to bring about, or produce. I did a little research on the word, and I found out that it refers to creating activity. It describes the act of making, producing, or creating. Poeo in the Greek. You know what blessed me even more? In Hebrews 1, verse 2, this word is used. This word, where the author of Hebrews says that God made the world through his Son. That's the same word as here. It's a creating word, right? And I see the sovereign king's authority in these words when he says, I'm going to make you, which they previously were not. I'm going to make you something that you were not. Now, obviously, this make you fishers of men is analogous to their trade. That's clear, right? Jesus asked them to leave their work, catching fish. And I'm going to make you fishers of men. And if he's going to make them, that means that their call implied intensive training. Right? It's analogous to, but it's of a higher order than what they were doing. I'm going to make you fishers of men. They were used to just being right there where they were in the Sea of Galilee, right? But I'm going to widen your scope. Men refers to worldwide. It actually transcends all national or social scales. I'm going to broaden your horizon much more than where you are now. Because I'm going to make you fishers of men. Fishers of men also has an Old Testament background. I need you to catch this. God talked about fishing in the Old Testament. I'm going to show you one instance. Jeremiah 16:16-18. He said, behold, I am sending for many fishers, declares the Lord, and they shall catch them. The context of this, by the way, is judgment. And afterward, I will send for many hunters, and they shall hunt them from every mountain and every hill and out of the clefts of the rocks. For my eyes are on all their ways. They are not hidden from me, nor is their iniquity and their sin, because they have polluted my land with the carcasses of their detestable idols and have filled my inheritance with their abominations. He's talking about judgment. Right? That's what he's talking about there in Jeremiah 16. Old Testament, the fishing speaks of judgment. Well, if the king is here, then isn't judgment coming?
Yes.
Y'all don't hear me. But Jesus takes this Old Testament language that speaks about judgment, and Jesus says, even in what he's going to make them, here's how to be saved from judgment. The way to be saved from judgment is through the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit will hook one and bring him out of judgment, and he'll hook another and bring him out of judgment, and he'll hook another and bring him out of judgment. Wow. Jesus says, I'm going to make you. Jesus is going to show them how to do it, and he's going to enable them to do it. Jesus says, all you got to do is walk with me. Listen carefully when I'm talking to Nicodemus. Watch me when I'm at Jacob's well with the woman of Samaria. Check me out when I'm dealing with the rich young ruler. Bag it up, put it in park when I tell Zacchaeus to come down. How about that in the warriors? Watch me when I walk by the tax booth and say, Levi, let's go. Have I got any warriors here? They're going to learn by looking at Jesus, because Jesus does not do evangelism the way a lot of the church world does it today, which is wrong and unbiblical. But he's also going to enable them by his spirit. What kind of call is this? It's an effectual call. It's an authoritative call. It's a call that demands Christ have the preeminence. It's a call that demands repentance and faith and trust and hope in Jesus Christ. And beloved, as I go to this last point, I want you to know this is salvation, period. Okay? We like to impose a cheap and easy believism. Don't we? This is not easy believism. And too many people saying they're saved,
yes, sir.
They're not following Christ.
Yes, sir.
Right? We want to impose this easy believism, especially when it comes to our family, don't we? And you do them an injustice. Yeah, they're going to get mad at you. But there's no evidence or indication that you're following Christ, and just because you believe, it is not sufficient, as you see here. Following Christ. It means there's a transformation. It means there's a true attachment to him. It means there's repentance. It means there's faith in Christ. It means there's an unconditional following of Christ. You can't follow Jesus standing still. Right? Do I have some warriors in this house? Hey, glory. Notice lastly, the response of full embrace. Verse 18. What did they do? Notice the full embrace explained in verse 18. The text says, I am not making it up. And immediately, didn't have to pray about it. Have I got any warriors? Immediately, they left their nets and followed him. Now, do you see why I set up the setting the way I did? Because they had not set it up that way. We were going to think they just put down their little fishing rod and then they have a 3 or 4 fish in the bucket anyway. And all they were doing was doing this for sport anyway, or just doing it for casual enjoyment. But you see why I set the setting up that way? These men were entrepreneurs. They had their own business. They were not indigent day laborers. But the text says immediately. Mark how should Christians respond to the word of God. Mark says immediately. Mark how should we respond when we hear the voice of Christ through his word. Mark says first of all immediately. Right? Immediately? What comes with immediately? Drop everything. Whatever you were hindering, will hinder you from responding to the word, drop it. Right? Hey, glory, listen to me preach. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Drop whatever will hinder you from responding to Jesus Christ, because this is the most important decision of all of life. If you can't drop it, you can't follow. The text says, immediately, they left their nets. Oh, Lord, help us today, working resurrected today. Get rid of this this easy believism, this I believe. You can't tell me I'm not. Well, if you're not following Christ, you're not believing. Drop it. What you got in your life? That's a hindrance. What you got in your life that you're trying to attach yourself to Jesus along with your stuff? Drop it. That's how you need to respond right now. Well, don't I need to go home and pray? No, it's the word of Christ. Drop it. There's nothing to pray about because the one who asked the prayer is the one that told you. Drop it.
Amen.
You don't need you to pray about what he said. He needs you to do what he said. And if you're going to pray about it, pray for strength to do it, but drop it. You think I'm making this up, don't you? Well, you need to look at the word follow. It's not the same word that Jesus used. It's a different Greek word, but this word follow that they used, they dropped everything, their necks and followed him. It implies fellowship, joint participation, side by side walking with another. So it came to mean to join one as a disciple, to cleave steadfastly to Christ, to conform wholly to his example in living, and if need be, in dying. That's what it means. Wow! Their response is directly consistent with his call. Glory. We got too many responses that are inconsistent with his call. Right? Yeah. You said that, but. It's not consistent with the word of God. It's not consistent with the call of Christ. But yet you say you're following. Notice that following is directly consistent with his calling. Right? These guys hurting the call, it's the most important decision in all of life.
Yes, sir.
It is. You know how I know that? I need this for my babies who may not know the Bible as well as some of you, but babies, Mark 8:36 says, for what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? And babies, if you go to school, you get a degree, you get all of that, but if you don't get Christ, if Christ is not first place, if Christ does not have the preeminence, if you're not following Jesus Christ, you may gain the whole world. You may make a whole lot of money. You may get a job in a big company. You may get that yacht on the water. You may get that house in the suburban area. You may drive that Bentley, but you will gain the whole world, but you will lose your soul. Nothing's more important than this. Don't get mad at me, parents. But I say to students, under the sound of my weak voice, if you got to leave college to follow Christ, then get out of college. Hey, glory. A college is taking you down and you can't handle what's going on the campus. Come back home. Get back to Jesus. Right? They have everything. Right? You can't serve God in things. Right? How do I know that? Matthew 6:24 is for my babies again. You can go on, join in if you want to. No one can serve two masters. Well, you need one. Hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God in money. You cannot serve God in people. You cannot serve God in things. You cannot serve God in your career. You can't serve God in your agenda. I hear you. Pastor, this was the disciples. He's not talking about everybody. I'm glad you said that. Because when the Spirit is working with me in my study, he brings questions like that to my mind. So I cover everything. Let's see. Let's see if he's talking to everybody. Mark 8:34. And calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said to them, the crowd, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Right? This is is all Christians. This is the same picture for all would-be disciples of Christ. Period. End of conversation. Y'all with me? Have I got some warriors? They left everything. Have you? Have you really left everything? What are you holding on to that you know is sin, but you've accommodated and gotten used to it, and yet you say, I'm following Christ? What is it? Have I got any warriors? Well, Pastor, they didn't become perfect, did they? No, they didn't become perfect. But they dropped everything they knew they should be dropping. I'm going to say that again. They didn't become perfect, but they dropped everything they knew they should be dropping. I'm going to say that one more time. You didn't get it. They didn't become perfect, but they dropped everything they knew they should be dropping. When I got saved, there was things I was doing that I knew was wrong before the Lord came into my life. So when I turned from sin, I dropped everything I knew I should be dropping. The Full Embrace Illustrated. I'm gone. Right? That's what Andrew and Simon did. Peter. Full Embrace Illustrated. Well, what did James and John do? Was it more radical than what Andrew and Simon did? The Bible says in verse 20, when they heard the call, they left their father. Yes. Is that what your Bible says?
Yes.
And immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee. They left him in the boat with the hired servants. They got out of the boat, left their father, and followed Jesus. What's wrong with these guys? They left their father. Which tells us, it doesn't matter how intimate the family tie may be, if it stands between me and following Jesus, I'm going to leave dad. Do you hear me preach your word? It doesn't matter how intimate the relationship is. If I have to leave father or mother or sister or brother and even forsake my own life, Christ is worthy of leaving everybody behind, forsaking any and everybody, because Christ must have the preeminence. Have I got any warriors? Do I have any warriors? Come on, young people. What girlfriends or boyfriends? You know I'm not Christians. You better leave them behind. Okay, Pastor, I'll call them probably tomorrow or Tuesday. No. When church is out, call them. When church is out, call them. When we dismiss, call them and say, I just heard the word of God, and I know you're not saved, but I keep letting you call me, I keep letting you deal with me, and I keep acting like you're my boyfriend, and I keep acting like you're my girlfriend. Well, I'm not going to act like that anymore, because I just heard what it means to follow Christ, and I've got to drop this now. Yeah. Have I got any warriors? Are you with me? Are you with me? And you know what? If you won't drop it, you can't have Jesus and him. You can't have Jesus and her. Have I got any warriors? You can't have them both, because this is not Burger King. You can't have it your way. This is discipleship. This is following Christ. Right? That's amazing. Can see Zebedee right now. Who is that? dad is Messiah. It's the one you talked about in the Old Testament. It's the long-awaited one. And he's calling us. And I do love you, dad. But you got to understand who's calling. And according to his call, I can't stay here in the fishing business. You got your hired servants. By the way, you know if he had hired servants that he could pay, that must have been a pretty good business. If he didn't have to have his boys with him and he had hired servants he could pay. So they left their father and a business that could have been turned over to them once he passed. Y'all don't hear me, do you? Right? Well, you can't give up all your livelihood like that. If Jesus calls for it, you must. Right? You must. I'm trying to tell you this morning that you must. That you must forsake everything and everyone that might hinder or be in the way of you following Jesus. You must. I'm not telling you you should. I'm not telling you you need to pray about it. I'm telling you, you must. Because that's what following Christ requires. Nothing, there's nothing shocking about this to me. I know too much about Jesus to be shocked by this. Amen. Right?
Amen.
Look who's calling.
That's right.
The one who stepped out on nothing. And said, let there be his calling. Amen. It's not simply another human being calling. This is not somebody that's simply a little bit better than my dad calling. This is the one who created my dad. The one calling me right now, this water that we're in, he's the one that spoke it into existence. The one calling me right now, he's the one that called and said, fish start swimming, and the fish started swimming. The only reason we got a chance to even catch any fish is because of him. And you think I'm gonna stay here and catch fish when he just said he's gonna make me fishers of men? Dad, I'm out of here. This is shattering, isn't it? But when you get hooked by Jesus, your whole life, your whole purpose in life is transformed. Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
All they do is fishing. But Jesus says, I want to make you fishers of men. So that means their whole purpose in life is now transformed. You got to follow him unconditionally. Absolute obedience, absolute sacrifice. Jesus didn't call any part-time disciples.
No.
You got to be prepared to leave everything.
Amen.
I'll deal with it later, but you remember Peter said that in 10, chapter 10, verse 28. He said, we left everything to follow you. They left their security because they found security in Christ. They left their livelihood because they were now trusting Christ for all their provision. Seems unreasonable and scandalous, doesn't it? It seems like it's too risky, doesn't it? It's not unreasonable. It is scandalous, but it's not unreasonable. They're not even given time to transfer whatever equity they may have or put it in trust. That's a radical commitment, isn't it? Have I got some warriors? That's pretty radical, isn't it? Glory to God. Don't worry, I'm rolling down. I'm out of gas anyway. That's pretty radical, though. They call to follow Christ. Jesus, are you saying fellowship with Christ surpasses all that we have and are doing right now?
That's right.
Yes,
but I love fishing. Jesus says, you don't know anything about love until you attach to me. You don't know anything about joy until you get attached to me. That choir was singing a moment ago. It's through his blood. I've been set free. And I got to sit in there. And I started telling him thank you. And I started giving him praise. Because I know it's through his blood I've been set free. You know, just that right there, what I'm talking about right there, I never knew anything like that before I was saved. I never knew any joy like that before I was saved. I never had any pleasure like that before I was saved. I'd rather fellowship with Christ. Right? Wouldn't you? I'd rather be an emulator of Christ. Wouldn't you? When you young people, you like to emulate and mark other people. Well, what about Christ? Because when it's all said and done, John will be gone. Kobe will be gone. Curry will be gone. Right? LeBron James will be gone. Right? I don't care if he does call himself King James. They don't care, no king. He'll be gone, right? But when it's all said and done, when he puts his foot on the Mount of Olives, you tell me what celebrity will have some clout there.
Yes, sir.
What money will Donald Trump be able to use? Will he be able to look at Jesus and say, you're fired? No, sir. No, sir. No, sir. Because when he comes back, I'm telling you this.
Glory.
The authority of Christ, every knee. Past the bow. Whether you want to or not. And it has nothing to do with what you want to do. It has everything to do with his authority and what he commands.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Amen. Real fire. Yes, sir.
Watch this, young people. The devil who told you all those lies about relationships, told you all those lies about how you ought to disobey your parents, told you all those lies about how you ought to scheme and do things and close doors and nobody's watching you, who told you all those lies about your secret life and nobody really sees what you're doing as long as you're hiding from them. Guess what? He's going to be on his knees too. I wonder what counsel will he give you that day? Because all you've been able to see him for is the liar that he is. Speak the truth. Run today.
Amen.
If you're not saved, run. I'm not telling you to run down this aisle. I'm telling you to cry out for mercy right now. You can stay right where you are in your seat right now, but cry out for mercy. What I need to say, Pastor, I do want to be saved right now. Say, Lord, I am a sinner. Have mercy on me. Save me. Save me. I want a new life. Save me. You better do some holy business. Everybody in here need to do some holy business.
Amen.